Welcome back. Now, let us carry on with some basic concepts in control systems. What are they? Okay, I think you've had it enough. System and interconnection of elements and devices for a desired purpose. Okay, this is the definition of system in control terms. Control system and interconnection of components forming a system configuration that will provide a desired response. Okay. More or less the same, but system now that it's doing control. What is process? Process, this is an intricate term. Process, the device, plants, or system under control. So when I talk about a process, you would immediately understand that this is the system to be controlled. So system to be controlled or system under control, is called plant or process. Okay, plant or process is the system to be controlled. The input-output relationship, sometimes we are not interested in the inside of this block, inside of this process. All we are interested in is input and output. Okay, what do I enter and what do I get? What do I enter as an input and what do I get as an output? So this cause and effect relationship, in fact, that relationship is the kind of description of the process. We have a couple of different terms for input. Okay, input is a very clear word. Input, you are entering. It is under your control. You are entering the input. There are also other inputs I'll talk about that it is not under your control. Input is also called stimulus or stimuli. Okay, stimulus. But another comprehensive concept or statement is desired response. I love this. Desired response. So you are introducing your desires. Hey, plant, please behave according to this desire, according to my desires. Satisfy my desires. Please keep the temperature of this room at a comfortable level. Please suppose that you got an a cruise system in your car. You just set it to, I don't know, 60 kilometers per hour. You just, this is your set point. You are entering. This is your input. And the plant is your vehicle. And you are ordering, or let's say, you are requesting your car to go at a certain speed. Okay. So the input is your desire. That's why it's called desired response. And you, what do you get is called output or just response. Or to differentiate this output response from the desired response, it's called actual response or real response, actual response. Okay, so very important terms, input or stimuli or excitement or set point, another word, another concept, set point, okay, set point, SP, okay, SP, input, stimulus, stimuli, plural, singular, whatever, desired response, and on the right-hand side, you got output or response or more accurately, actual response. Okay, and this is so-called control system. Now let us look at what is open loop and what is closed loop. Open loop, versus closed loop. Well, the first configuration given in A is open loop. This is open loop, right? Why open? Well, there's a contradiction, open loop. So there is no loop, in fact, open loop. So no loop, maybe. No loop, because look at this. There is only one direction of flowing the action, the signal, let's say, from input all the way to output. There is no loop. There is no sort of, what should I say? There is no feedback. It's coming now. Look at this. This is an open loop control system. Is it bad? Not at all. Much more straightforward, more much more more easy to achieve, less costly, I mean inexpensive, etc., etc. Very good. But for example, suppose that, okay, you are heating up the your room, okay, you know that if you give that much energy, okay, you just maybe turn your knob to the right or to the left, okay, and if there is no closed loop, no feedback, you just give some certain energy or open up the valve to some degrees, okay, you get a desired output, in fact. But unfortunately, we are living in a world that is full of so-called disturbances. Disturbances. What are the disturbances for a temperature control system? Outside temperature, right? Outside temperature is changing almost constantly. So your control system has to overcome, okay, the changes imposed by those outer effects called disturbances. Look at here, disturbance one could be, as I said, if this is a temperature control system, a disturbance is the output temperature. In the springtime, the outside is at a comfortable temperature level anyway, so your system doesn't need to even work. But in these times, the outside temperature is around 5 degrees Celsius now, so we need some heaters, and those heaters have to increase the temperature of the room to a comfortable level. So your control system has to overcome this disturbance. Another look at this. The input is entering, that this arrow entering to the system, input. This is another input, in fact, input. But the difference between this input and this input on the left is so clear, isn't it? This input is, yeah, another word, very good word, reference, input, stimuli, or stimuli, stimulus, set point, or reference signal. You are giving a reference. Hey, I wanna get this level of temperature, okay? So this is the reference or input. You are entering, but here those inputs are out of your control, coming from outside. This another disturbance may come from, I don't know, it's some electrical noise can enter to the system to force to change some parameters. Okay, so if you want to constantly overcome those time varying disturbances, okay, you need to do some measurements, okay. Hey, you measure if your desire is satisfied or not. You need to measure it, okay? So you are now, we are closing the loop. This is closed loop control, okay? Closed loop control. Or feedback control. Sometimes it is if you want to emphasize this negativity, negative feedback control. Why negative? It's coming now. So look at here. You got an input transducer. Why do we need input transducer? I'll talk about this on a case study. But you are now in our example, you are controlling the temperature. How do you enter your temperature set point? There must be a sensor. For example, PT100. For example, LM, what was it? That integrated circuit, LM35. Maybe some thermocouples. Okay. I don't know. Some sensors that produces electrical output with respect to the temperature at the input, okay? So you need an input transducer to transform this physical variable other than electrical to the electrical ones. And then your controller, okay? We will go inside the controllers so that your controller can deal with the electrical signals, okay? And then this is the disturbance. The disturbances can be any physical parameters like wind speed. For example, you are controlling the position of an air vehicle, okay? You want to keep it at a constant altitude or road, but there are some winds and I don't know, some other effects due to air pressure, turbulences, etc. Those disturbances try to change the position and speed of your air vehicle. And so your control system has to cope with those outer effects. But those outer effects in the end are sensed by sensors, and then your controller, as I said, produces some control actions to overcome those disturbances. Now, here, whatever those disturbances are, okay, they are affecting the output, but if we are correctly measuring, okay, measurements. If you are correctly measuring the output by means of an output transducer or sensor similar to this one, and then feeding back to the input for comparison. Now the simplest question: how do we compare two things? How do we compare two things? For example, I am I don't know 80 kilograms. Okay, I'm not a fat guy. I'm 83 kilograms, and I've got a friend who is 120 kilograms. You wouldn't believe. Yes, 123 kilograms. Let's say. How do you compare? Okay, you can just by looking at, you can compare it. But mathematically, how do we compare? The subtraction is the most convenient way of comparing two things in the same unit. Okay, so difference between me and that friend of mine is 50 kilogram. It is the difference. So subtraction is the most convenient way of comparing two things, comparing apples with apples, of course. Look at here now. So we need a kind of comparator. It'll come. It's a kind of amplifier which amplifies the difference in the input terminals and produces output. So this is called summing junction or summer in some other books, summer adder, whatever. But forget about this, summing junction, let's say summing junction. Summing junction, look, compares the input with the output. And the difference is called error signal. Error is the difference. Let's say that this is the reference signal, okay? And this is the, I don't know, feedback signal, okay? The error signal, which is represented with E, is just the difference between the reference signal and the feedback signal, okay? This is the error signal. So it is also called actuating signal. Why? Because it actuates the controller. If there is no error, okay, if we are living in a perfect world, okay, if there is no error, we don't need any controllers because everything is under control. There is no error, okay? But we are here to correct to those errors, okay? We are here to correct those errors by means of the controller. So the error signal, if it is zero, if the input is zero, the output is gonna be zero or an output that is provided before, since the controller most probably has a memory, okay? But if the error is zero, that means its duty is done. Okay, it is not working anymore because you know his duty is successfully finished. But as I said, there will be constantly measurements because the disturbances are changing. We keep measuring the output, okay, sending it back for comparison. And this comparison produces an error signal. And this error signal is manipulated by the controller. Okay, or processed by the controller to manipulate the plant so that it could produce desirable outputs. I think this is the main idea behind the feedback control. Let's go back to this CD example. That singer has a new album and he or she got feedback from her or from his fans, okay? Let us, you know, think that the singer had some criticisms as well, or some of the songs are so slow, almost boring, okay? So the singer will produce more lively, you know, songs because he or she got feedback. Hey, okay, your songs are okay, but they are a bit too slow or they are a bit too fast. Oh, they are not peaceful at all, you know. Just sort of noise. So in the next album, I'm sure the singer is gonna work with some other composers to produce more peaceful, let's say, songs. Anyway, so feedback is important everywhere. How do you do feedback? Basically, you measure the output and compare it with your desires, with your input. And the difference is called error, and you deal with this error so that you reduce it to a small value or more ideally to zero. Any question about feedback? It's coming more. Let me ask questions at this time. This is a simple table comparing the open loop, okay, with closed loop. For example, cannot compensate for disturbances that affect the plant. Is it open loop or closed loop? Open loop, because open loop systems cannot compensate for disturbances that affect the plant, because you don't know what's going on at the output, right? You are not measuring. If you are not measuring, in fact, you are not controlling. You are just controlling for one case. You just, you know, furnish your controller, set it up, calibrate it, and then leave it working. For just one operating condition, it is okay. Okay, suppose that the outside temperature is constantly at 5 degrees, day or night, at any season. Suppose that outside is almost, not almost, always at 5 degrees. So you don't need a closed loop or feedback controller. You just heat up this, give that much energy, do a good calibration. If I feed our heater with that much of energy over this, constantly, I get this temperature, that desirable temperature. In some countries, there are some countries, for example, my friend used to work in a university in, where was it? In Kenya, I think. He said the temperature, outside temperature is 20 or 22 degrees all the time, you know, all the time. So you don't need any feedback because it is well known. There is no uncertainty, no need to measure. Okay, but we are not living in Kenya, or we are not living in ideal conditions. We need to measure the output and then do comparisons. Higher accuracy and robustness to disturbances. Higher accuracy and robustness. I'll come to this word or concept of robustness later on. So, of course, closed loop systems have higher accuracy and they are more robust. They are not easily affected by the disturbances. That's what robustness is. How about this? Commanded by the input. Open loop systems are commanded by your input. Whereas closed loop systems are commanded by the error via feedback. Look at here. The input of controller is the error signal, right? The error signal, not the input directly. The difference between the input and output, let's say. Whereas here, the controller is directly, after, of course, this transducer, directly commanded by the input. Whereas in feedback systems or in closed loop systems, the controller is commanded by the error signal. Commanded by the error signal, which is produced by feedback. We call it negative feedback because there's a negative sign here. Okay. We are not, in fact, interested in positive feedback. Okay. negative feedback. Okay. Well, unfortunately, closed loop systems are relatively more complex, more complicated, and more expensive. Now, because you are using sensors and transducers, okay, they are not cheap, and you are doing other designs. Of course, improved performance and improved stability, are achieved by closed loop systems. Simple but a nice table comparing two main configurations, which are open loop and closed loop. Okay. Now, well, open loop systems, another way of depicting open loop systems: controller, actuator, process. What are they? We'll see in a case study. Okay, input. Look at here. The input is now error after feedback. You may be dealing with more than one variables. It is called multivariable control. If your controller is controlling temperature, humidity, and pressure, as an example here, at the same time, it's a multivariable control. There are some examples. You have a look. Please do read through them. For example, now almost all cars have ABS braking systems, anti-lock braking systems. Look at here, the car braking at this point. Okay, this is with ABS, very good maneuvering. But this is without ABS. If it is a slippery road, okay. If you are, speeding, it is not easy doing this maneuvering with ABS. It is okay, but without ABS, you just, hit it. And this is another example. I'll come back to this with a numerical example next week or the week after. So this is a vehicle suspension system, so-called quarter car model. This is the tire, and there's a suspension system. The main idea is keeping or increasing the comfortable level of the passengers in the car, so that they cannot get these nuisance effects when the car hit those bumps or dropped those uneven roads, let's say. So your suspension systems has to compensate for these disturbing oscillations, right? So they've got this is the mass of the body, this is the spring of the suspension system. By means of controlling this damper, okay, you immediately compensate for this nuisance disturbance and try to keep the body of the vehicle at a constant level while your vehicle, your the tire with suspension system is vibrating or oscillating. Okay, so this is the vehicle stays almost at a level. Okay, so the vehicle, the passengers in the vehicle would not be affected much, at least, but the suspension system compensates for those oscillations on its own. There are so many nice examples. Some of them will be covered during the lectures. Well, when you don't say, when you are not emphasizing that you are working with computers, I mean, you are doing, you are working with microcontrollers, digital signal processors, and so on. You mean that you are doing continuous time control. Continuous, okay. Time control. In other words, you are doing analog control. Analog control. Continuous time control. What is continuous time or analog control? Analog control, you are working with real world signals. What does that mean? They are continuous in time and also in amplitude, continuous. But if you want, if you are doing analog control, you are using analog devices. Analog devices, what are they? For controllers, I'm gonna introduce you that this unique device called operational amplifier. Computers of the past, but they are still in use, they are still very good. And they are so fast because they are working in continuous time, they are analog. Analog is, you know the word analog, you got digital watch or analog watch, I don't have any watch now on me. Anyway, the analog is kind of opposite of digital. We are gonna do continuous time control or analog control in contrast to digital control. Digital control, there's another course called digital control. I think Alparslan Hoca is delivering this course. I also give this course here at Yıldız, digital control. In digital control, you are converting the analog signal from the nature, let's say, to digital signals, to represent the signal with bits or zeros and ones, right? I don't know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Let's get rid of this. Suppose that you got an 8 bits analog to digital converter. Now you got only bits, and the signal is sampled and represented by like this. Okay. So this is called digital control or discrete time control, which is out of our scope. Okay. So if we are doing digital control, instead of using operational amplifiers, you are using computers. Well, what I mean with computers is microprocessors, digital signal processors, microcontrollers, like, you know, Arduino, Raspberry Pi, or those ARM-based microprocessors, so on and so forth. They are all considered as computers, and they are all digital. You got a clock, and you are doing digital to analog and analog to digital conversation. So your controller algorithm is run in the computer. But we are not doing this. We are using those operational amplifiers. They are just referred to with this short way of saying op-amp, operational amplifiers. Operational amplifiers are in fact doing all kinds of operations, including summation, subtraction, multiplication, division, integration, derivative, integration, everything. All math operations can be done by op-amps. Okay, as I said, they are the computers of the past. But they've got some advantages, also disadvantages. But you need to start with continuous time or analog control. And that's what we are doing in this course. Now, let us give some examples to open loop and control systems. Let's first look at this example. This is a toaster. Okay, this is a toaster. This is a thermostat. Okay, this is a thermostat. What is it? This is toaster. This is just door opener for handicaps. Okay. This is a vehicle, okay. Which option most correctly describes those devices that are closed loop systems? Conventional toaster, is it a closed loop system? Thermostat and ABS in this vehicle, are they feedback or not, or closed loop or not? Conventional toaster and ABS, wheelchair accessible push button door opener, conventional toaster, thermostat and door opener. Let us start from A. Conventional toaster, is it a closed loop mechanism? Does it have a closed loop system controller or not? How does it work? Or iron heater, okay. Or washing machine, okay. Dishwasher, what else? Iron heater, washing machine, dishwasher. Are they Let me give some more examples. Iron, heater, washing machine, dishwasher, do they have a closed loop system? Any answer? Let us be a little bit interactive. Okay, let me talk then. Monologue is good. What is the purpose of using an iron and ironing some clothes? Okay. Your shirt, for example. Heater. What is that? Kettle, right? Water heater. If water heater, actually water heaters can be considered feedback because you can change the output temperature. But iron, for example, if you leave it is dangerous, you know, it heats up and up, okay? There is no feedback. Washing machine, for example, washing machine. It seems it is a complicated and nice, very nice device, okay? Or dishwasher, they are very, very helpful, okay? Not only for ladies, for us as well. They're very, very useful. But, for example, let us talk about washing machine. You put, the clothes and you choose a program and leave it to work. The machine works and it follows that program you chose until that program is completed. Okay, your clothes may be so dirty or moderately dirty, or you may put brand new, very clean things to your machine. It doesn't understand. It just follows that program. So it is an open loop system, right? It doesn't measure the hardness of the water. It doesn't measure the amount of detergent. It doesn't measure the degree of how much your clothes are dirty. After the process, after some time, it doesn't get feedback if they are clean enough. The Arçelik used to have a model called fuzzy machine. There was a sensor that it was measuring the turbidity of the water and assessing the cleanness of the clothes and deciding whether to stop or to finish the process or not. So it was a kind of feedback. Normally, washing machines, dishwashers, heaters, they may have timers, they may have some programs, but since the output is not constantly measured and fed back for comparison, you know, to the input, they are not considered as feedback systems. Whereas this simple mechanism, toilet reservoir, you wouldn't imagine. It's a very nice example of feedback system, but mechanical feedback. You just, after your business is done, you just flush the you know, reservoir, and then it'll start, you know, getting water up to some level. When that level is reached, the inlet, you know, is shut. So there is no more water is coming, and no flood, nothing. So toilet reservoir is a good example of feedback system. Cruise systems, of course, is such a nice example of feedback system because you are setting up the desired speed. Even if your car is climbing a hill or going level or going down a hill, it keeps your set speed, velocity. Okay, so beautiful feedback system. It keeps accelerating, braking, whatever, but regulates the output to satisfy your needs. Elevators are good. Good example also. Elevator. I put it in. What can I say? This is a new telephone, so I'm not so familiar with its all functions. I'll put it in flight mode. What happened to my screen? What happened to my screen? Here we go. Okay. I gave so many examples. Let's go back to this problem. Now, which one is the correct option? Which one is the closed loop systems? So, conventional toaster. They are not feedback systems. Thermostat is okay. Door opener is not. You just command by your hand, it just opens. There is the message. I am recording the lessons. What is the last message? ABS. I didn't see those messages in time. Never mind. Excuse me. Thank you. So there were some answers, but I missed those chat box messages. Here, the correct answer is this, because thermostat is a feedback device, and ABS has, because it detects those sliding effects, skip and skid, it's called. Conventional toaster is not a feedback system. So correct answer is B anyway. Now let us see a couple of examples from the history, okay? This is an amazing guy, Al Jazeri. He lived back in 12th century, end of 12th centuries and early 13th centuries, during the Artuklu or Artukids time. He built so many machines, okay, working with feedback principles, and presented his machines to the Sultan of Artukids, Artuklu Sultanına sundu onları. So many machines. He lived around Diyarbakır, Mardin, and the Sultan ordered him to make a book full of its plans of his works. So this book is available, and these machines are built actually and exhibited in somewhere in Maslak. Where was that place? So you can visit. There is also another exhibition place in where was it? Sultanahmet ne parkıydı o? Allah Allah. Ankara'ya gidiyor. Neyse, Gülhane Park. Ha, orada da var. Bir de Tix'te satılıyordu bir ara biletleri. Anyway, so this is an amazing guy, and there's a couple of even companies called automatic control company, well, automation company called Jazeri, Al Jazeri. So they are very famous all over the world. He is very famous all over the world. And there are very nice examples built in the history in this part of the world, in this in Anatolia, during the antique Greece. Very nice machines, mechanical systems with feedback. You may look at this before Christ, so 2000 something years ago. Float regulator mechanism. But more recently in Holland, for example, in 16th century, before the electricity is in use, temperature regulator. Amazing, isn't it? But this is the most popular example, I mean, most popular application by, what was his name? James Watt, yes, Scottish engineer, right? He, because the industry revolution took place for the first time in England, right? And textile industry was very important, and his and those textile machineries were powered by steam engines, right? And controlling the RPM or the rotating speed of those machinery was so important. And this guy, James Watt, found or furnished this mechanism, this rotating mechanism with this feedback system, look at this, if the rotation is too fast, okay, by means of this centrifugal force, these spheres go, away from the center, and it opens or closes something here, so that it regulates the stream flow to the engine. Very nice system using this simple physical rule, centrifugal force by James Watt. This is water level float regulator. You just use float mechanism to control. It's a kind of reservoir control system, you know, reservoir water level control system with nice mechanical feedback. When the level reaches at some level, this float closes the water inlet. There are James Watt centrifugal governor for the speed control of the steam engine from 18th century. These are important because they are industrial achievements, all right? They are not just for fun. They are not just built to please the sultan of the time, right? They are industrial. They are devised of, let's say, capitalism, you know? So they are considered as industrial revolutions, industrial discoveries. So James Watt is number one in feedback control system achievements. Now other automatic controls for steering ships. Ship steering is very important because transportation by sea was very important, is important. So steering ships is an important issue. In fact, those engineers are studying control systems, very carefully. So they are control systems are good for them. In 1930s, here we come, Nyquist established first mathematical preliminaries of design analysis and design of controllers, stability control, especially after using those lamp transistors, right? Then in 1940s, closed loop frequency response methods made it possible to design linear closed loop control system. Time of body is coming, body. Then starting from 1950s, root locus method, we will cover this. We will cover body as well. And then in the recent years, the control systems are applied to even non-engineering areas like biological, biomedical, economic, and socio-economic systems, digitalization in factories, industry 4.0, IoT, Internet of Things, etc., etc. So control and automation systems now, they are everywhere. You have a look at this. I derived it from Richard Dorff's book. It's another nice book. What else I can talk about before finishing today's lecture? You have a look at those examples, all right? Look at this manual liquid level control. This guy is constantly watching the level of the liquid, so that by means of regulating this valve, so that the there's fluid input and fluid output, the level is constantly at a certain level of the water or the liquid. Now, of course, devices are now doing this. Everything is now becoming intelligent or smart. So by means of making devices communicating each other, intelligent systems, decision making, self decision making systems are becoming popular. So man machine interface is important. You have a look at them. But this is a nice flow chart, so called. I prepared it for you. Control system design process. First, you need to establish the control goals, then identify which variables to control, or most of the time we use CISO, single input, single output system. So identify the variable to control, write the specifications for the, and its opposite is MIMO, multi input, multi output systems. Write specific for the variable, establish the system configuration, obtain mathematical model of the process, the actuator and the sensor, or the whole system has to be modeled or has to be represented by mathematical equations so that you can design a controller and then optimize the parameters and do this iteration if the output is not satisfying your needs. Okay. You should know these primary reasons to build control systems. First, you do power amplification. Maybe you wouldn't imagine this easily. You are, by just rotating a small button or knob, you are controlling such big systems. A vehicle, I don't know, a satellite dish, a radar. You are controlling big systems with your small finger actions. So power amplification, control systems are used for power amplification. They are used for remote control. You don't have to be within the plant to be controlled, or you don't have to be by the, you know, side by side the plant to be controlled. You just control it remotely. And convenience of input form. You can control the temperature, velocity, pH, altitude, etc., etc. But in the end, you are dealing with either voltage or current, electric variables, right? So, convenience of input form. Compensation of the disturbances. You are compensating for the disturbances. So, four main reasons: power amplification, remote control, convenience of input form, compensation of the disturbances. This is the, let us see that design example. Shall we take a break or are we doing okay? Give me some 10, 15 minutes and then I'll finish everything, okay, for today's lecture. Is it okay? Any objection? Let me finish today's course within 15 minutes max, okay? So no break. One message received. I think continue. No problem. Thank you for your support. Okay, so I'll continue. If there is one single objection, I'll stop. Because it's your right to have some break. Okay, so no problem. Thank you. 15 minutes. This is the most, I don't know, the simplest transducer. Sensor or transducer. What is this? This is a kind of, the circuit people say, voltage divider. Or as a device, they say, potentiometer. I hope I'm not doing any spelling mistake, huh? Potentiometer. Let us represent this as a box, okay? The output is voltage, okay, volts, and the input is how much you rotate this knob, okay? So input angle. By rotating this, let's say knob, shaft, whatever, okay, this arm goes up and down. So you change the amount of resistance, right? So that you are changing the volts that is achieved. Let me draw this like this, okay? Suppose that this is a resistor, okay? This is your input. No, it's not a good way of showing it. This is your input, okay, from here to here, VI, okay? This is your output, and it goes up and down, okay? V0. So you, by means of rotating or traveling this up and down, you get various different voltages, okay? Where am I gonna use it? You can use this anywhere, you know, volume up, volume down, rotate little bit left to the right. Let us see in this example. This is antenna azimuth position control. What do we have? What are the components? I don't know how much it is clear. Let me enlarge this little bit more. Okay. Antenna azimuth position control. This is the dish, okay? And suppose that you want to rotate it, I don't know, to some degrees, okay? You got this potentiometer. I just scribbled on the upper slide. So you enter your desired azimuth angle as an input here, okay? Okay, you say, hey, rotate this much, that much, to the left, to the right, whatever. Okay, and this is the amount of rotation, theta, which is measured in radians or in degrees, okay? The command goes to the motor to rotate this to the left or right. Let us see this in a more detailed way. This is your input potentiometer, okay? This is your command signal. This is called differential amplifier. It is also power amplifier. Differential, as the name states, differential amplifiers. So this is the plus terminal, okay? This is the negative terminal coming from the output. And the difference is amplified. This is negative. This is negative because it's coming from output. Okay. And this is the error signal, the difference, which is sent to the motor to rotate this. This error must be positive or negative with respect to the rotation achieved at the output, okay? And the difference is fed to the amplified and fed to the motor to rotate the dish. But look at here, let us see this as a block diagram. Oh, this is a nicer drawing. Look at here. This is the input transducer, okay, potentiometer. And this is, you just rotate this and get different voltages, different values, and feed it to the differential amplifier from the plus terminal. And this is your motor, okay, you are feeding the motor by means of this power amplifier. And motor, this is the shaft of the motor, okay? And this is the gear, because you wanna reduce the speed to increase the torque, okay? gear, and this is the representing the satellite dish. I'll just write dish, okay. All these bodies have an inertia, have some viscous damping, so they are represented with inertia and damping. So you are rotating this, and how much it is rotated is sensed or measured by another potentiometer at the output. And because here you are rotating the potentiometer by hand, but here the potentiometer is rotated by your dish, okay? How much rotation is achieved is sensed here and sent back for comparison, and this differential and power amplifier detects the difference or the error and amplifies it to feed the motor until you get the desired position so that the error becomes zero. Okay, this is what we are going to how we are going to represent these diagrams with electrical mechanical components. We just represent them with boxes, with blocks. Okay, with boxes or blocks. So angular input is converted to electrical input. Look at this. Voltage proportional to input. Potentiometer. Potentiometer does that. Okay. This is summing junction. In fact, it is just an amplifier. Okay. It has positive terminal and negative terminal and produces one output, which is this output. Okay. And it is the error signal, of course, because it is the difference between the input and output. And this is your controller, okay, drives the motor, rotates the motor to, well, drives the motor to rotate the dish. And you measure the output and by means of another potentiometer, feed it back, voltage proportional to the output, feed it back to this amplifier to compare the output with the input. And this action carries on continuously. Okay. I think I need to stop, right? You know, I've got another 5 minutes. This is an aircraft. It has some control surfaces for rolling, yawing, and pitch up and down. Pitch for pitch motion, you use ailerons. For roll angle, you use rudder. What else? Pitch, roll, yaw. Roll for these aileron deflections. For roll angle, you have a look at them. Design catenary. I'll skip this. No need. More example, biological system. So yes, I want to speak on this plot. Okay, look at here. We are, as the name of the course implies, we are working with dynamic systems, right? We force the systems. This is input reference and this is output, okay? Unfortunately, we are so bad, we are forcing the systems to behave as you wish, right? We are not leaving things on their own. We want to increase the temperature of this room. We are not happy with the outside temperature. We are not happy with the, I don't know, for speed of the car. We want to increase it. We want to go faster and faster, whatever. So we are changing the positions and velocities of things that we are using. So we are introducing energy or input, right? Input and getting output. So input, the most basic representation of input is a step function. Step function is this. Before time starts, okay, it is zero. At time zero, it is a level, okay? What does that mean? What does it represent? It may represent anything, really. It may represent here floor four, for example. You wanna go to, you wanna go up to level four. You are using an elevator, but it could be the temperature of the room. Hey, keep the temperature room. Keep the temperature of the room at 18 degrees. So it could, this could be an 18 degrees of Celsius. Hey, keep it at that level. Keep the motor rotation at 1000 RPM, revolution per minute. Keep the altitude of the aircraft at 10,000 feet. Keep the pH level at, I don't know, 5.5. So you are ordering, okay? You are not changing the trajectory. You may do that. You may increase the output. You may want to increase the output over time, like a ramp. There are some other input commands, but the most basic one, the most popular one, the most common one is step function. Step function, okay? Because you are doing position control is so important. Okay, so you are ordering, so this is input command. This black line is your input, okay? So you push the button, okay? The motor, the electric motor of the elevator started, okay? Because it was just in the standstill state, okay? It started and started to move and rise the elevator cabinet, all right? Up to some level, okay? And it reaches at that level and keeps this level. So the this blue line is called time response. Or just response. Let's just say time response. Time response. Can we say that time response here has two main parts? Two main parts. We can. Why? Look at here. As these arrows are showing, one part is evolving over time. One part is evolving over time, changing over time. And the other part is not changing at all over time. The level is the same. Okay? So this part, this first part or this initial part is called transient part, transient response. Why transient? Because it's not permanent, it is transient, transient response. You will see that it is also called natural response. Why natural? You'll see. Time response, or let us call this total response, okay? Total response, okay? What is the next or second component? It's called steady state response. Steady state response. Steady state response, okay? Steady state response. It is also called forced response. Forced response. Those concepts are so important, but the good thing is they are so meaningful. I'll explain. In fact, you know this. How do we represent dynamic systems mathematically? With, remember from math courses, differential equations, right? Differential equations. Do you remember the solution of differential equations? I'm sure you do. Homogeneous solution plus particular solution, right? Homogeneous solution. I'm so, you know, ashamed now. There's a mathematician in front of me, but sorry about this. Okay. The solution of differential equation has two parts: homogeneous solution, particular solution. Since this is a dynamic system and can only be represented by, in fact, differential equations, basically, they've got their solution, or their response is a solution anyway, has two parts. Like now, instead of using homogeneous solution, we're going to say transient response. Why? Because homogeneous solution is a function of time. It is something temporary, which is also called natural response. Why? Because it is created by the nature of the system. What is the nature of the system? Because of its weight, because of its friction, because of its flexibility, because of its Young module, because of whatever, because of its kind, because of its softness, etc., etc. So it's coming from its nature. So you have to first cope with its nature, okay? You have to lift its weights, overcome the friction, okay? First you are doing this. And then, so this part is basically created by the nature of the system. You are forcing to change its position, okay? And then this part, steady state response, is created by your input. Well, all the things is created by input, but the apparent effect is seen at the steady state part of the response. So the steady state response, we can say, is created or is also referred to as forced response. Why forced? Because it is forced by your input energy to rise to that level, okay? It is called, in mathematical terms, it's called particular solution. Why it is called particular solution? Because it is particular to your input, not to the nature, to your input. It is particular to your input. It is not something general. It is particular to your input. You are introducing an input function, okay? So this is very important. The time response, if you introduce some inputs to a system, the system will react to your input, okay? By changing its position, changing its speed, etc. And if you record this changing the position, okay, you will see that this record is called response, has two parts. The first part is called transient response or natural response. And the second part, which goes forever, you know, until you leave it, called steady state response, forced response. Let me finish it here. It's 20 past anyway. So thank you very much for being with me, for, you know, attending this class. Please do attend my classes and try to follow the courses carefully. Very simple things I'm going to explain. Okay, the course is simple, but things are add up and add up. And if you don't follow and if you don't do the assignments, the quizzes in time and with good, efforts, it'll become really difficult in the midterm and final exam. Also, you will see that the subject matters are really important in your professional life or in your student life for other courses as well. For example, believe me, I understood the beauty of differential equations or the usefulness of differential equations in control systems. So the differential, working with differential equations, with working with linear algebra is not just for fun, it's not just for brain exercises, okay? They are really used in this course, okay? So look at here another picture. Here, which part is transient response? The part, it keeps evolving up to here, maybe here, okay? So this part is, well, let me be more accurate, from here to here, okay? Oops. So from this point up to here, it depends on your assumptions, actually. Let's say up to here, okay? Let us not be so fussy. Okay, this part is called, if the output is referred to as C, okay? C transient, okay? And from here, to infinity, it is called C forced or C steady state, C natural, okay? And the total response, again, the total response is the transient response plus forced response. Okay, next week we can do a recap anyway. Okay. Bye-bye then. Thank you very much. Okay, it is written here as well. There is a message. Have a nice day to you all as well. Have a great day. Good day. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you, Sanna. Stop share and meeting for all. İyi günler, iyi günler. Teşekkür ederim hocam, sağ olun.